All right, it's a brand new day and also a brand new week, and you're welcome to Enterprise Morning on Enterprise TV. I am Henry Igwebike. Right, and Bait will be going to our newspaper headlines to see what they have for us this morning. And right after that will be I'm in conversation also for this morning, while we get everything all sorted out for you and just for you, because you're special, of course. Please do well to visit our website at www.enterprisetvnews.com, and also do follow, like, and comment on all our social media platforms at Enterprise TV 7. With me in the studios to make sense of our newspaper reviews today is Mr. Cyril Abaku. He is a public commentator. You're welcome to Enterprise Morning today.
Thank you, Henry.
All right. So quickly, let's move to our first daily for today. And this is coming from the Punch newspaper. And the big story there says, kidnapping epidemic, tracking device shortage hindering police probes. And that's coming from the sources. And also on the bottom slip of the same newspaper, we have NDLEA declares a beauty queen wanted, nabs Brazil returnee. And also on the top slip of the same newspaper, we have IRS demands Achimogu's tax returns after lavish birthday. And also, federal government appoints a six governments to minimum wage panel. Yes, so that is coming from the top slip of the same newspaper. And also, we have Mali, Burkina Faso, Niger yet to exit formally, and that's coming from ECOWAS. Mr. Cyril, we have two awesome stories here, and I love us to start with the issue of a beauty queen that is nabbed or is declared wanted by the NDLEA for what they said was drug trafficking. Tell us why would a beauty queen invest in such a trade, knowing her symbolism to the society?
Let's just say that up until this moment, this is an accusation. The NDLEA is accusing her of being the perpetrator of this act, and they are alleging. She's not even been arrested. She's not been taken to custody yet. They will have to effect an arrest. They may have to also take her to court, you know, where they will now prosecute and seek to convict. So for now, she is an innocent person. I say this because sometimes, I mean, who knows? Oftentimes, the NDLEA will act on the tip off and say they got intelligence that so-and-so thing was happening in so-and-so place. You remember the other one that they caught in at VGC?
Yeah.
Nobody would have imagined that in such a highbrow area.
Highbrow places.
People, but I mean, and there was a two-month or two-year-old baby in the house. So you were likely to look away, but they went down and the man even pleaded guilty. All right? So in the case of this lady, I'm just trying to throw the discussion into a very broad place. Who knows what if somebody went and planted those things in the house and they went and picked it, and you know. But the fact is, now she's been declared wanted. So she has to now come and clear her name. But to come to your question, you see, when certain ills or menaces thrive in society, thrive conveniently, thrive very strongly, it means the people who shouldn't be the ones doing it are the ones who are actually doing it. A beauty queen, you think that she's up there, she has everything. But yet, what was she looking for? Money, connections, what is it? Sometimes when they've gone to some of these big places and come back and they want to continue living that high lifestyle, their maintenance is always high. So sometimes you find that they want to do just anything they can do, if only to maintain. There's a lot of money in the drug trade. It's illicit money, but there's a lot of money in it. So what did they find in the house? As the story went, an electronic weighing scale. Was she checking her weight every morning to see whether she was still in shape or what? Drug packing paraphernalia. What are those for in the house? Then I think they recovered the Canadian loud. Okay, so it means for her to be doing this, people of her class, people of her caliber, should also be. Is a network. So it's not high alone. You see, and this is where the real issue is. Sometimes, again, the sort of expectation we have of them, a former beauty queen, anytime you say she must be coming up from an exotic car, she was living in a big neighborhood. But the reality is that people who have done this sometimes lose their touch on life. They forget that they're human beings who became what they were. I have some of them as friends, and they are normal, they're human beings.
Mm.
But sometimes, in fact, in the year, somebody wants to do three transplants, the person's face could go from purple to blue to brown. The eye wants to go from black to purple. You know that. So the pressure sometimes also. But the fact is, what is wrong is patently wrong. If Miss Christmas Adele Inouye is indeed as guilty as she has been accused, then the NLA should not only declare wanted. I want to hope that they have everything to be on her heels.
Because the reason I am asking this, you know, when such issues or when such tip-off, comes to play, it's often the fries. People are called the fries that are often the main target, while the agencies, authorities forget about the bigger person. I want to believe she wasn't the person that initiated the deal in the first place. There would have been somebody bigger than she is who introduced her into the scheme. So why aren't we talking about, nipping it in the bud exactly and going for the big wigs?
So don't take anything away from it. When you see people who do perpetrate crime, it's like in universities, when they want to inject people into cult, they say so-and-so person is part of us. So that sort of gives some legitimacy or courage to the would-be initiate to say, come and join. You're going to belong to a group that, comprises some of the biggest names you can think of. When you have people like this who have walked the runway, who have made a name for themselves as it were in society, who are up there, when you hear that people like this are part of us, there is a sense in which their market seems to be stronger. That's one. Number two, the things they found from a house don't look like the biggest things there are to the drug market in Nigeria, as far as I'm concerned. She's a fry. She's a fry. Now, who was she fronting for? Who is her own supplier? And whom does she supply? If you check very well, we've been saying this thing time and again that Nigerian drug busters they call them at the airport. And that the interceptor is worth $25 billion. Somebody is investing that money. The person you caught is a courier. As far as we've been going after couriers, we have not gone after the godfathers and sponsors of the drug market in Nigeria. Because somebody who can invest $30 billion, could be a politician, a big time businessman, or somebody who is higher up in government, who is then an enabler. But to think that the person you caught at the airport or somewhere is the person responsible for such a humongous sum of money being put in, is a joke. Because you don't raise that kind of money being a bus conductor. You don't raise that kind of money being a journalist. You don't raise that kind of money even being in government for a day or two. People who are able to invest, those are big investors.
True.
So, but there's been no serious high profile arrest. We've been going after the fires, and people are now beginning to say, they are used to the NDLA strategy, and I can tell it, and I can tell you very easily. It is always on Sunday afternoons and Sunday evenings that you check, go and check all the newspapers we've been reviewing. If you checked it, you would find that every Monday there's a front page of NDLA Intercept, NDLA. It's always on Monday mornings. They intercept on Sunday night, then on Monday morning.
It makes
that the only thing we can do? Of all people that they've been arrested, how many people have been prosecuted as a celebrated national prosecution and sent to jail in the past 5 or 6 years that Buba Mama has been at the NDLA?
Exactly.
So these are the questions. Where are we really going with this drug war?
True. So let's talk about still keeping up with the Jones. We have a story here of the IRS demands Achimugo's tax returns after lavish birthday party. This made some headline news in the past week. And the question is exactly, is the IRS playing to the gallery?
No. So the IRS is not the FIRS. FIRS is Nigerian, right? The IRS is the American version of the FIRS, and believe me, in Nigeria sometimes we do man no man or face no face. That is, who you are determines how you are treated, right? But in America, the IRS has been known to bring down a lot of big celebrities. In America, the law is the law. It doesn't matter who are on which side of it.
So does it mean she is a U.S.
No.
Citizen, because why would the United States IRS be asking her for tax returns?
No, so
if she's not a dual,
international and tourism is not a very straightforward thing. sometimes you may go and spend money. So again, it's like extradition treaties. It depends on what the two countries, America and Grenada, may have together in terms. Yeah, so if you went and spent some amount of money in a country, then that there will be concurrent jurisdiction that enables, that makes America to say, okay, they can ask these questions. Or it's possible that she has business branches in America.
Yes, okay.
And so if the CEO proprietor of that company is spending such amount of money out somewhere, in their own laws, there could be a corresponding requirement for them to also file tax returns. The point is, when the money that has been quoted that she spent in Grenada, the question is, did she pay tax on it?
But if you mean, before you go for what, for the benefit of our audience and viewers who might not know, who is Achimugu?
Okay, Aisha Achimugu, from the little we know, is an Abuja-based businesswoman who was previously married to the former to Suleiman Achimugu, who used to be the managing director of PPMC, a subsidiary of the NNPC, who died during COVID-19.
Oh, okay.
So she's a widow. They had three children together. She turned 50 last week. Last week, and on account of that, had a celebration in Grenada. Where she invited, well-wishers, close friends to Grenada to enjoy, to have fun. Mm-hmm. Let me just put that to have fun. Mm-hmm. So that the lavish party they had there, and that is to put it very badly.
What drew the
attention of the world of Nigeria to? She herself came back and said that she was seeing the attention she was getting, and that she relished it because it had made her become the most famous person in the world after Israel and Gaza. Being cheeky,
wow.
But that much she has. That much I can say about Achimugu.
All right. So let's move to the next daily for today, and it's coming from the Nigerian Tribune, and the big story there says ECOWAS shaky as Niger, Mali, Burkina Faso quit. And the writer there says their withdrawal notification not yet received, but it says more divisions imminent. NIIA direction once. And also we have a story of a US-based lecturer accidentally shot dead in Osun State, and also committee on national minimum wage to be inaugurated on Tuesday. And also we have a story on the top slip of the same newspaper: governors can't fund state police, and that's coming from also Dima. And the writer there says Southwest governors or government talking with the federal government on Amoteco carrying arms, and that's coming from Oyebanji. On the bottom slip of the same newspaper, we have how NAS has been violating constitution since 1999, fails to inaugurate constitutionally approved a committee. Mr. Cyril, let's talk about this issue of government not being able to fund the state police if given the opportunity, and that's coming from Ozo Dima. How true is it, knowing that these people get security votes now and then what is that meant for if state governments can't fund a state police if the opportunity comes?
I don't agree with Ozo Dima. I don't agree with him. That is his own opinion. There's this saying that where they say everybody says it can't be done until someone got it done. So I don't agree with him. The question is, if the federal government gave corresponding economic power to the states, couldn't they then go ahead to explore their mineral resources, create wealth, and fund their police? Why would you say the states can't fund police? Is that not what they should have been doing in the first place? Can any country say it cannot govern itself? Is it possible? Every society, security is the first instinct. If he was talking about, I believe that today, if it were left to some governors to fund their police, like you said, they get a lot of money in the name of security vote. How much does it take to fund the police? Some states get some of the least states even get up as much as we are getting up to 300 million. This was about 5 years ago or 6 years ago.
And he is one of those governors that had taken in some mercenaries.
Imo is an NDDC state.
Yes.
Which means they're getting money from different sources, from more than just allocation. So why will he now say that they won't be able to fund the police? Is a weak argument. You see, there are some things that if you know you can't do, step aside. Don't say it's not possible. Just take a walk, resign and walk away.
Mm.
And let the person who can do come and get, of course, come and get it done.
Mm.
If he was coming in for election, will he say it's not? He will tell you that he's going to do
it. Yeah, he can
do it. So why is he in government now saying it's not possible?
Mm.
State governors can. The problem, look, like I would say, if you want the right to minor resources, if you want the right to till your earth to till your earth and be the owners of your resources, oil, coal, tin, whatever it is, you must also, every right comes to responsibility. You must also be willing to shoulder the responsibility, because that's the discussion when we talk about fiscal federalism.
Mm.
You own what belongs to you. You must also take responsibility for managing everything that will pertain to you. Okay?
Mm.
If he's saying that in the present structure states cannot, I don't believe him.
Mm.
But in the best scenario is when they will have the power to run their own affairs. They should be able to do it. If you can, like I said, if you cannot do it, you should take a ban. Let someone else who can come up and get it done.
All right. So let's look at the expertise of Cardoso. Experts are deferring on Naira exchange rate floating. Now, I would love you to, in a minute, just help us run through who Cardoso is, where he's coming from, and if really he is good enough for the job he has been given.
Mr. Cardoso, for me, is not a bad fit for the role.
Okay.
I don't think he is. No, quite frankly speaking, I don't think he is. The argument has been made. I support the argument that I would rather have an economist, a macroeconomist, run the CBN.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not that straightforward. In terms of exposure, in terms of years of experience, in terms of his learning, I don't think that being governor of the CBN should be difficult. It's like saying you've been playing football for let's say 15 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Like Lionel Messi, for example, he is an experienced player.
He on could the global set. Stage, yes. Do you think if he comes into Super Eagles, he could be as awesome as he was?
In the Cardoso instance, it would be for him to referee a game.
Oh, okay. And not really participate in the
match. No. It's because CBN is regulator.
Yes.
He's to referee the match. I believe he can. In fact, I would say that because he's been playing and because he has an understanding of player fitness and all of that, whatever it is, he can referee the game from better experience. It could be said that we could put it that way.
Hmm.
On the other hand, could be let us go and get a referee who is trained to be a referee, thoroughly professionally trained. So he's been to refereeing courses, all right, and then he becomes a so he's a referee through and through. He's not like a player who converted into a referee, because a lot of players actually convert into coaches.
Yeah, true.
All right. So that's the argument here. Cardoso could make it, but the issue always is this. Does he have all the autonomy, all the liberty, all the freedom that he needs, that is required?
Is this an issue of autonomy, or is it an issue of competence? This point, we shouldn't be doing experiment with our financial system in Nigeria.
I mean, that's another argument, but I think that right now, this Naira may not recover anytime soon. And this won't have anything to do with Cardoso. You see, the thing is, even that attempt to have the CBN's headquarters, the CBN's key offices come to Lagos has been rejected politically, not economically.
Oh, okay. So what is the underlying?
And the people who have the power to reject political laws have the power to determine this rate is. I'm not talking about the rate in the black market.
Exactly.
So who runs the black market? Don't give me an answer.
Mm.
The black market is run by those who are opposing the relocation of the CBN's offices to Lagos. Is it getting clear to you?
Okay.
Is it getting clear to you, sir?
Yes.
So they have the power to punish Cardoso with this consequence. So at this point, it's no longer about whether Cardoso is doing well or not. But Dr. Cardoso himself hasn't been able to come into the CBN with quick action.
Mm.
It doesn't look like as soon as he came, he was able to reverse the fortunes.
Mm.
Things have gone remain on a downward slide. And this current move to move the CBN's offices to Lagos won't help matters. So we're stuck. I cannot. I mean, again, when you are when you're in an office and things are not happening, there's no other way people will discuss it other than to say you may not. It's possible that you are not a square peg in a square hole.
Exactly.
So if that's where the efforts are going, I think their concern is based on fact, which we cannot see, right? Yeah. So it hasn't come in as an active ingredient or as a drug to quickly or change it and say remove it again. But I tie that to political will or to political economy, because you see the thing is this: Emefiele now is being, you have when the former president said he was the one that told Emefiele to implement recoloration,
yes,
or decoloration, or denaturation. The fact is that Emefiele, if political authority had told him don't do it, he would have got it done.
True.
But he was given the fiat, go ahead and do it. So with what marching orders does Dr. Cardoso have right now? Do we know? We don't. So that may be, that for me, I think is the remote issue. But the immediate issue, the current issue now is that even if he was to do everything he could to reverse this policy, with the attempt to move the office of the CBN to Lagos, they will tell him, I'm sure that those who have, these people that have the power to effect or not, you see that the ones who are also saying you can't move. So he will have to trade. He will have to. And right now, this dollar, the naira may hit 2,000 before the end of this
year. It might.
That said, this thing is not going back anytime soon.
It might, really, really. So let's move to another daily, and this is coming from the Vanguard newspaper. And the big story there says Burkina Faso, Mali, Niger pull out of ECOWAS. And also on the top sleeve of the same newspaper, federal government inaugurates minimum wage committee tomorrow. Corrupt governance responsible for insecurity, banditry in the north. And that's coming from the Shetima, the vice president of Nigeria. While on the right, we have Afenifere expresses worry over upsurge in kidnapping in the southwest and other parts of the country. Insecurity, we are taking fight to criminals again. And that's coming from the federal government. Forex crisis, high import duty to press vehicles or other imports into Nigeria. So, Mr. Cyril, let's talk about this issue of Mr. Shetima, saying that corrupt governance responsible for insecurity, banditry in the north, knowing that Shetima himself was one time a governor, isn't it?
No.
And why would he now say he is a victim or he's a casualty of what he was part of many years ago.
I remember when Mr. Shetima was governor of Borno State and there was a bombing in Konduga. There's a village called Konduga. He got and said he will not leave Konduga until the matter was resolved. But he left Konduga. Konduga is in ruins. He went to Konduga and said he would remain there with them. He will not take a move. He will not take a step out of Konduga until the people like in fact, he left Konduga. Now he's vice president. Konduga is in ruins. This was the governor when he was governor of Borno State. They went to Chibok, kidnapped those schoolgirls, took them away. The principal was not around to perform her duties as principal. He rewarded that woman with commissionership in Borno State. WAEC told him, they said, we cannot come and hold exams in Chibok because it's not safe. Chibok and another government area. He said they must come to hold the exams in Chibok. WAEC wanted them to come and write the exams in Maiduguri. He refused. He was one that said he should come to Chibok. I mean, some things, people say that this sort of thing is, my friend of mine used to say, it is visible to the blind and audible to the deaf. If you can draw the line together, it is up to you.
So the question is,
so today, hold on. Today, yes. In the APC, he's been a senator.
Yeah.
In the APC, the president Buhari was there. When was Boko Haram born? Arguably in the twilight years of Yaradua's presidency, right? Jonathan related to, but Jonathan decimated Boko Haram, limited them to a small parcel of land. When Buhari came, they expanded. Under Buhari, former president Idris Deby of Chad, one day launched an onslaught. In fact, they even entered Nigeria.
Yes, true.
They beat Boko Haram back to the point that they were just Nigeria. Now you can't finish them up. They were like Brother and Co. They were like this. Boko Haram expanded again. go and check how much we've spent on defense in the past, say roughly 10 years. Is in it runs to billions of dollars. And yet, so who is he blaming Buhari or is he blaming his own government?
Very true.
It's a
rhetoric question.
He needs to say I blame Buhari, I blame Jonah. He should call names.
Or himself, because
he's in government. When you say these sort of things, look, you see, part of the challenge we have is that public office holders in Nigeria don't think they owe us to raise the bar for public conversation. Because if that were truly the case, and government is saying this, they need to name names and arrest people and prosecute. You don't just come out and say, thieves are the ones who have stolen so and so. So are you a journalist? I need to tell us what's going on, or to give a solution to what's going on. Even those who do weather forecast tell you, you need to take umbrellas. Solution point. It's true. So you don't come out and say, corruption is the reason. And you are in government, and you don't know who is corrupt, but you just say corruption is the reason why. You're not a public affairs activist. You are vice president, for goodness sake.
Who should put
so that solution? So if it means you know a little more than we do, you must have names, you must know how much the two have taken, and you must be able to now help us to make sense of it and bring closure to that issue, not just to come and say people did this and people did that. He is about to spend 15 billion naira to renovate his own house. And that's not corruption.
All right, so in 30 seconds, I'd love you to talk more on this issue that's coming from Pa and Debanjo. If Tinubu misses this opportunity, Nigeria is gone.
Well, it's not the first time we will hear this statement being made. It was said of under Obasanjo, it was said of under Jonathan, it was said of under Buhari, of course, at least in the early days of his government, and now we are here. I thought Pa Debanjo, Pa Debanjo has always been very vocal and clear about the fact that even Tinubu may not be the answer to the problem. But if he's now coming to say that Tinubu is the last chance, but does President Tinubu seem to be like that? Moving the CBN and fans to Lagos is good, but is that like priority policy?
Yeah, exactly.
I support, but it doesn't look like priority policy.
Does it come in the?
How does that quickly reduce food inflation?
Exactly.
How does that quickly? It is not out of place to expect quick answers to Nigeria's problem today. If any leader is able to give us that, it won't be out of place to say we're expecting quick answers. It won't be out of place. It won't be out of place because the things to do are basic. There's no renewed vigor in against insecurity. There's no renewed vigor in reviving the economy. There's no renewed vigor in creating jobs. There's nothing. We're just there. Now they're talking of tracking devices to track Abuja. I'm like, see, and the punch is even saying this morning that there are not enough devices. Are you kidding me?
In a country where
we're talking about tracking devices today, we were told in the days of yore that the new number plate we're going to be using will have something, an electronic, infrared, whatever,
a device
to track. It didn't happen. Why don't you can even find out who made that promise and was money released and why, and arrest that person and say, come and give account of what how you know. I always reason, I'll close with it, Henry. I'm going to say this very boldly, that very soon the sun of justice will shine on this country, and it won't set until the common man has got his satisfaction. It will come.
All right. We hope so. We hope so. I'd love to say thank you to Mr. Cyril Abaku for being part of our morning show today. Thank you so very much. So when we return, Mali, Niger, Burkina Faso withdrawal from ECOWAS over suspension. That in a bit. When we come back, please don't go anywhere.
Enterprise TV, a tradition of truth.